Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
How you doing?
Yeah, I'm doing. Thank you. All right, good morning. Welcome to the March 26, 2018 called meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, and we are all present. Just so folks know, if at any time somebody needs assistance with a hearing aid, if they need something to help them be able to hear better, county staff does have hearing aids available. If you inquire of county staff, they'll be able to help you with that. For our invocation, if you care to, join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this morning. Thank you for the opportunity to do the work of this county. I just pray that your hand of blessing would be on the county and on this board as we consider decisions today that affect our future, that you would help us to make decisions that are in keeping with your plan and your vision, and that all we do would bring glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Will you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, my understanding of the purpose of this meeting is to consider factors pertaining to the issuance of new debt should the bond packages that are possibly going to be on the ballot in November, should those bond packages pass, how can we take steps now to address what impact that would have on the county's finances, and whether there are decisions that we can make as a board that would reduce the property tax impact, and to discuss those factors publicly. So I guess that we will turn it over to the county manager.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning, commissioners. This time I'd like to distribute to you the newest versions of the capital plan that we've been working on. I know that we've been through several drafts. I want to make sure you got the most recent version in here. This morning's discussion. So
okay.
If this matches the one that you have, that's okay.
Always.
Right, there's been a lot of work put in behind these over the past couple of months.
Okay, so for disclosure, so that the public knows what it is that we are looking at, this is the report that was drafted by Davenport & Company, who is a group that was hired by the county to help us to understand sort of the long-term fiscal impacts of the bond should they pass, right?
That's correct.
And it's dated March.
And this one is dated March 26, 2018.
That's correct. We feel like this is the most accurate version of this plan. And I'm going to describe a little bit about the process for your benefit and for the public, too, as I go through a PowerPoint presentation this morning.
Let me ask a quick question.
Yes.
Has this plan been made available to the press yet?
No, it has not. Not this version.
Do you think that maybe we could do that?
Sir,
we have
yes.
Copies for the press this morning so that they can look at that as we follow along.
Yes. So thank you, Madam Chair. My plan this morning is to go over a brief overview of this plan and process, just kind of remind everybody how this has gone. We're also going to, as the Chair mentioned, talk about factors that will impact the possible property tax rate increase that would be needed in the event both bonds were to pass. And just for clarity, for our planning process, we've chosen to look at that scenario. Both bonds pass at the amounts that they've been presented to the board at this time, because that is the most expensive option that we would be trying to plan for. Thus, it would have the most possible property tax rate impact. So that's what we'll be talking about for the most part today. So with no further ado, we'll go ahead and get started. So just kind of a reminder of how this process has worked. In January of this year, county staff, myself, and Susan and Andrea began to meet with folks from Davenport. And we provided them with our financial data as of this year, as of 17-18, where we are this year. And they began to incorporate it into the book that you have in front of you today. Then in February of this year, we spent a lot of time meeting with Alamance Burlington School System and Community College staff. We met with both staffs from both entities to make sure we fully understood their bond information. We had an idea of what possible operating cost impacts their new facilities might have to county government's finances. And we also wanted to make sure we understood the timing of their projects. And we don't want to lose sight of their ongoing facility maintenance needs, things that are non-bond. And again, that information is, once again, all incorporated into the plan book that you have in front of you. So this month, in March, we've been trying to communicate to the commissioners information that you need to help you make decisions. At our last meeting the other Monday, you got a lot of information from me and from Ted from Davenport about debt capacity. Where is the county at today with its debt? How do we stack up against our peers? And I think what we've done is demonstrate that we can, in fact, take on more debt. We can, in fact, take on the $189.6 million worth of proposed bond projects. We can't afford that. We can do it and maintain our current good financial health. And in fact, if we work hard, I think we can do it and maybe even upgrade our bond rating. So we feel like we've demonstrated that we can take on more debt. Now the question is the affordability. How will we pay for the debt? And that's what we're going to talk about today. These are options that you'll need to give some consideration to today. So as we worked on our plan process, one of the first things we wanted to do, and again, this is incorporated in the book you have in front of you, is identify what we are paying out today for capital needs for county government, for Alamance Burlington School System, and also for the community college. So we wanted to look and say, okay, how much are we paying out this year at a 58-cent tax rate for all debt service and for all repair and maintenance? That's our annual non-debt, non-bond needs. So you can see on this slide the total dollar amount that the county is paying out in 17-18. This fiscal year is a little over $12.5 million.
Is this on a particular page in this book?
Yes, it's on one of the early pages. I'm sorry, I don't have it in front of me. But it is incorporated in the book. All of this information is.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to know the page that's on.
Okay. I think Susan could probably find it quicker than I can. So.
And Ron, could we generalize this some?
Certainly.
It's a little
Bruce, can
hard
you
for me to read.
There we go.
Thank you.
Page 17. Page
24.
So it's page 24? So we can look at page 24 in our books.
It's a more condensed version up there, I believe.
Yes, this for the presentation's purposes, I've just tried to put it all in one place. And
I just want to know where I could refer to it without calling you.
Absolutely.
Brian, I might suggest, on this slide on the screen, you have county, schools, and community college.
Yes.
The county detail will be most easily tracked next to page 21. Then the schools on 22 and the community college on page 23. I think that's going to be the easiest for you all to look at to really tie out to these numbers.
And those are... That's the existing today's conditions.
Correct.
For county government, for Alamance Community College, and for the school system. This is a summary of it. You can see that our total capital cost for 17-18 is $12.5 million. Our total debt service for 17-18 is a little over $9.8 million. That's 2.1 for the county, 5.6 for Alamance Burlington School System, and a little over $2 million in debt service payments this fiscal year for Alamance Community College. Then the middle column shows what we're calling PAYGO or CIP. That's the annual amount for repair and maintenance each year. The county has $250,000. Alamance Burlington School System, a little over $2 million in 17-18. That is all lottery and sales tax dollars. and then Alamance Community College at $440,000 for annual pay. So this gives you an idea. This was important. We needed to look at this for planning purposes. What are we getting for a 58-cent tax rate? This is what we get, $12.5 million worth of capital payment. So after we identified in the book what we're paying out in 17-18, we needed to take a look and say, where did those funds come from? Where does this money come from that we're using to make these capital payments? Basically comes from three sources. Property tax dollars. The capital monies also come for the schools, come from the lottery funds, and those funds are restricted, of course, to only be able to be used for the school system. We have sales tax is the third source. We have two parts of sales tax. Some of our sales tax revenue is restricted only for Alamance Borough and the school system and can only be used for their facility costs. And then we have the other portions of sales tax that are unrestricted, and we can use them for any purpose, and we do use them also for capital. So when you look across the columns now, you can tell from this slide that the county and the community college, almost all of our and the community college's capital dollars, that's our debt service payments, as well as our PAYGO, our annual needs, are coming from county property tax or county sales tax dollars. Quite different from the school system. The school system in 17-18, only $130,000 of their capital funds is coming from county property tax or sales tax. The vast majority of the school system's capital funding and debt service payment is coming from restricted sales tax and their lottery funds. So another important piece of this plan as we look at how we're going to use these revenues is that we have to make sure that whatever we do according to the terms of the plan, we always use Alamance Burlington school system's funding from lottery and restricted sales tax just for their needs. We're required by law to only use lottery funds and restricted sales tax just for Alamance Borough school system. So this gives you a picture of what's happening with the school system in 17-18. And this is all important because this is kind of 17-18 is a baseline year for this plan. So in 17-18, what's going on with lottery funds? The school system will spend $1.4 million in lottery funds in 17-18. $450,000 of that dollar amount is for their debt service. A little over $1 million is for repair and maintenance projects. Then also restricted sales tax, we track it specifically for school system use, specifically for their facility needs. In 17-18, we'll be using a little over $4.8 million of restricted sales tax for debt service for the school system. And we'll be using $1 million of restricted sales tax for their annual PAYGO. So if you remember, we budgeted this year $1 million for school system capital needs and their capital outlay. That is restricted sales tax dollars. And there is a reserve that we predict there will be a reserve this year of $964,000 that we will, at the end of 17-18, move over into the school's capital reserve. How did that happen? Well, we have consistently been paying down the school system's debt, right? And we've been using, for the past 2 or 3 years, we've been using restricted sales tax revenue to do that. We've been paying it down. They haven't been taking on more debt, and the sales tax has been growing. So we project that we're going to have an extra $964,000 that is school system sales tax money that we have to put into their reserve accounts.
When would you say was the last time we raised property taxes for any of the debt? How far back?
I don't know, Susan. Is that something you might could help me answer? Because that's
let me look up that.
Okay.
Now, while she's looking that up, can you go back to where you had what 9.8 service?
Yes.
Now, assuming that was higher last year and the year before and so forth, would I be correct there?
Yes.
And we're zeroing it out within how many years? 7 to 8.
Yes, I believe so. That's right. Correct.
Right now, today, and obviously more. Last year, fiscal year prior to that, how many pennies on the tax rate is that 9.8 today?
One penny on the tax rate today is $1.3 million. So quick math might be roughly 6 to 7 cents.
6 to 7 cents, okay.
Yes.
All So in theory, you at 6 to 7 cents, if you maintained it there, could finance new debt.
Yes, that's kind of getting to the gist of the idea behind this capital plan. We're going to move to in this plan, whether bonds pass or not, mm-hmm. as we pay down debt, we will no longer transfer it over to cover new operating costs. We're going to leave it in the debt budget and the capital budget. So we're able to use the money we're paying today for debt, even as that debt's shrinking. If we leave those funds allocated mm-hmm. into capital, we'll be able to continue to pay for either new debt if bonds pass, or projects as they come along, but it will stay in the capital budget. That isn't what we've always done in the past, and it's just been because we've had needs on the operating side. But in looking at how do you keep the property tax impact low on a $189.6 million worth of new debt, that is a key. You have to keep the money you're spending for debt now in debt, even as you pay it down.
Now, I did ask and didn't get an answer about what was the highest dollar amount debt service that we were putting out for debt service, you know, not obviously it's not now. As far as the dollars put out,
I think we have that information. It was the highest was a little over 13 million in 2013. So I think over the past 5 years, our average debt service payment has been around $10 million. 2013, we had some refunding bonds that were done. We refunded for the school system, so our highest debt service payment that year was $13 million.
$13 million on
that's 10.
About 10 cents.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
That's correct.
The percentage of the entire operating budget is that we should.
Well, and I'm talking about, you
on
know.
Pack trade.
We didn't roll taxes back. We didn't cut taxes back as we lowered the debt, you know. Right. I don't think we're going to do it this time. And, I'm working on the same thing, maybe a little bit more.
I think we're
seeing the bridges analysis versus this high, nicely paid Davenport. So,
well, and again, let me reiterate that's the key to
say the word highlight.
The key we're seeing to keeping the property tax impact rate lower if the bonds pass is to freeze the debt payments and leave it in capital, not go over to operating and start covering new projected operating costs with it. Leave it in the capital to make sure any capacity we realize by paying down debt goes on to new debt. Okay, so that kind of gives you an idea of what's going on with the school system dollars. This is very important to us because we're going to be talking today about some models here that combine revenues and use revenues to their best advantage. I'm assuring you that we're looking at making sure lottery funds and school system sales tax are always used properly in the way that they're supposed to in this plan. So this speaks to just what we were talking about. As we develop this plan and continue to look at it, what we've came up with is the idea of current revenue amounts continue to be budgeted for facility costs, not over to operations. This is just reiterating what we just said. As we pay down debt, we repay debt service, we keep that money in the debt budget, in the capital budget, especially if we're looking at these bonds passing. It's critical to keeping the tax rate impact low. So all this is incorporated in the plan. This is what Davenport has helped us do, has helped us map it out. This is a very detailed document that you have here that has all the supporting evidence for what I'm talking about to you today. But the things that we need to talk about today are the options that will affect the property tax. The bonds, as I said last time, if both bonds pass, it is going to require a property tax increase. How much should that increase be? That's what we're going to talk about today. And there are several factors that we need to discuss that will affect that. And what we hope to come away with today is, after we get done discussing this, is the passage of a resolution that's part of the LGC application for Local Government Commission. We have to submit the resolution you have in your packet today down to the Local Government Commission. They require that the commissioners establish the max estimated property tax rate impact. Okay, so that's what we're going to try to do today. If you do that, we'll put in the resolution and we'll send it down to the LGC with the first resolution that you approved last Monday where you set the max not to exceed dollar. And it's important to note that today as we talk about this resolution, when you set this property tax rate, this is the rate I believe the public will really hear and think that it's possible it could be that high. So I do ask you, as we go through this, to ask questions if you don't understand what's going on, because it's important that we set the right rate, the right estimated rate. We talked with our bond attorney. We will have some room to deviate from this rate that we set today, but really in the process of selling bonds, let's say interest rates go through the roof, right? And the rate we talk about today no longer works. The board at that time would have the ability to set the proper tax rate to pay. But we really need to try to set today what we think it would be in our best faith, in our best efforts. So we're going to talk about timing of borrowing for projects for ACC and ABSS. We're also going to talk about debt capacity. We talked a little bit about that already. We're going to talk about the options that you have as far as timing a property tax increase. And we're going to talk about structuring debt. So let's start off by a little discussion about the timing of the borrowing. If you remember, a number of months ago, county staff was asked to come up with a projection of what roughly $190 million worth of bond debt would cost on the property tax rate. At that time, we weren't sure about project timing or the real details. We just had roughly $190 million. We came up with, if that money was all borrowed at one time, all issued at one time, and had to be paid back at one time, that is the most expensive option it could possibly be. That's where we got this 12 to 13 cent possible property tax rate increase. Well, we know after spending time with the community college and the school system staff that that is not the case. It's not going to be a case of the county borrowing all that money at one year, issuing it all in one year, and having to make payments on all of it in one year. You can see in the book, all this is reflected in the book, this is just a summary. Community College is planning on borrowing about $27 million by fiscal year 21, and the remainder of their projects are staggered over fiscal years 23 and 24. And the Alamance Borough School System, they would borrow their $150 million that would need to be starting to be paid on by year 2020. And as we talked about in the past, we've tried to also incorporate county government and the criminal justice system that we support's needs into this plan. We've talked about $5 million in deferred maintenance for county government and the criminal justice system, as well as the fact that we're working on our facilities plan. We estimate roughly $15 million as a placeholder. But all of that has been timed in the book to have no impact on the property tax. So we have done that specifically to make sure that county government's needs would not be impacting this property tax rate increase.
And we wouldn't be borrowing for that.
The bond would not cover those items, only the projects that have been discussed by ABSS and ACC. For county government, it could be some kind of installment loans, those kind of things. But all of that has been deliberately timed to not affect needed property tax rate increases.
Is that reflected on one of the pages in this?
Yes.
32.
I'm sorry?
32.
32?
So that's if there's no... We haven't mentioned the possibility of a sales tax. So this is if there were no sales tax referendum that were to pass in November and it was all put on the property tax.
Yes, yes. These numbers that we're talking about now are all, that's exactly right. They are all related to the fact both bonds passing and there's no sales tax, Article 46, new dollars to help. So, you know, our original estimate in that case was 12 to 13 cents. That was the highest possible estimate it could be. Well, we know that's not what's going to happen. That will not happen. We've worked with school system and ABSS. They've shown us their project timelines. We've worked with Davenport to figure out what would that mean, changing it from all of it happening in one year to over a period of 4 or 5 years. Basically, it means the property tax impact would be 10.05 cents. From the commissioners do nothing else. County does nothing else. Just the timing of the projects that ABSS and the community college have communicated to us means that we would be looking at a property tax impact of 10 cents. So
that's,
this is, I'm sorry.
That's line 42, column K on page 32, is that right?
Line 32.
32.
Yes.
Yeah.
That is correct. And on page 32?
I think by that time, by 2020, interest rates are going to be double what they are now.
That is certainly possible.
It's going to be double what they are now.
And I believe we figured a conservative interest rate of 4.5%, Ted and Mitch, in our plan. So that's higher than it is now, but still we felt like it was conservative because we don't know what interest rates will do in the near future.
Well, I know what the Federal Reserve, the history has always been. and it's always going to be what it is.
Yes.
So I don't think you'll be able to borrow by 2020. You won't be able to borrow that money for 4.5. Six is probably closer.
Well, that would certainly have an impact on this, on the needed property tax rate. And again, that's where whatever rate you set today, if that's the case we find ourselves in, let's say both bonds pass and we set a rate today that we think is the best guess that we can make, and in, when it's time to borrow, if the interest rates have gone through the roof, we will have the ability to set the, do the property tax as we need to based on the conditions that we're borrowing in.
The Federal Reserve's already said they're going to raise interest rates 3 times this year, and they just done it a week ago the first time, so they got 2 more this year, and they go up 0.25% each time. So
that's important to keep in mind, indeed. Yeah. And that's the, yes, sir.
Maybe we can have, not for today, but by the time this gets finalized, a sensitivity analysis at various future interest rates at the time of borrowing.
Certainly.
You can see what it looks like at 6%, for example.
Certainly could
yes. Well, and we've been rather, we've been also been conservative with other factors in the plan. We've been conservative with our estimates for sales tax growth. You know, and we've also been conservative with our estimates in the lottery fund increases annually. So I would tell you this is a conservative estimate plan. What Mr. Lashley is discussing is important to bear in mind. It would also have bearing probably on construction costs, too. Your dollar may not go as far in future years as it will today.
And inflation, yeah, it's definitely going to increase the inflation.
These are all important factors to bear in mind. I think for our purposes today, you give it as much credence as you think is necessary as we talk about the possible rates that we could set. So the thing to carry away from this slide is we've gone from 12 to 13 cents based on staff's best estimate several months ago to 10.05 cents. That right now, that's where we are today without taking any action. That's what we think the property tax rate would need to go up without any further action or decisions by the Board of Commissioners.
Help me with the logic here. You're getting ready to pay down your debt service that's equivalent to, I think we're saying, 6 cents today. And I'm missing something. I got it.
Okay. So where did that
and
go?
You're talking about 10 cents on top. That's 16 cents right there. And you had it as high as 13 cents, I think, at the peak or at the apex. So if you had 13 then, and we hadn't raised taxes since then, or you hadn't taken on any major debt, I mean, as far as new bonds, and you got 10 here, that's 23 cents that, I mean, what am I missing?
Well, we still have the original debt that we owe on. So we still have all the school system debt that we currently owe. We still have county debt that we currently owe. And this 10 cents would be in light of us taking on $189.6 million worth of new bond debt. So what we're saying in the plan is if we froze our revenues, we froze everything we're doing in fiscal year 17-18, continued to pay that amount even as we pay down debt, once we add this $189.6 million over these couple of years, we're still going to need an additional 10 cents to make the bond payment, to make the debt payment.
In conjunction with the 10, as Tim saying, that we're already paying our debt service.
Yes.
Yes. Zeroing that out.
But it's declining. Yeah. The principal's declining.
Yes, it is. It is going down. Yes.
Yeah.
A lot. I understand. Still don't understand my answer. Can I get you to comment on that in lay terms? I can understand, please.
Sure. So I think what you're saying is, within the last 5 years, when your debt service was higher than it is today, you were allocating how many pennies?
10 cents,
right. And between that time, when your debt service was at the higher level, you were equivalent of 10 pennies, it's now lower at, what did we say?
We're at 9.8 million in debt service this year.
Pennies?
Approximately 6 to 7, yeah. Yes.
So my understanding is that over the years, as your payments have come down, while you haven't changed the tax rate, those certain number of pennies have been diverted over to your operating
which
budget.
We're not going to divert anymore.
But you only have 6 to start with. We can't claw back. We're not anticipating clawing back the 10. Those are already committed in the budget.
But if you come down to the 6, and you raise it 10, why are we not at 16 cents versus a lower number to finance the debt? I mean, does it take 16 cents to finance that much debt?
Well, it takes an incremental 10 pennies from what you have right now under this scenario. Yes.
To finance that full debt.
Right, and remember, really that also includes the pay-as-you-go capital that all three, the county, the schools, and the community college are putting into their system. That's not debt, but it is rolled into this plan. So this plan is measuring the equivalent number of pennies on the tax rate that is needed to service the debt you have today and all the new debt we're talking about, plus to continue to put into your facilities the pay-as-you-go cash funding that you're
Well, let me ask you this. Let me turn the question around. Let's say we owed nothing today, and we borrowed or put out the bonds for $190 million. What would it take to finance that?
If you give us a second, we can do that math for you.
Very well. Well, I'm going to continue on, and Ted, when you get to that point, just stop me and we'll share that data. So there's also the issue for the board to consider. So really what we've talked about here is, based on our plan, based on the current data, based on the current amount of debt that we owe, based on the desire to continue to be able to support the school system and the county government and ABSS with their annual project needs, not just the bond needs, we foresee a property tax rate of 10 cents just based on the changes that have occurred with the timing of the project. So this factor, the timing of a possible property tax increase, this is one where the board would need to give some indication of what the opinion is. So you have two options when it comes to property tax rate increase, again, assuming both bonds pass. This is so assuming that both of the bonds go forward and we are having a bond debt of $189.6 million. So you have two options. You can either do a natural tax impact, which is where property tax rates are increased, but they're only increased in the years that the bonds are sold and you need the money to start making the debt payment. There's a pro to that. The property tax only goes up. It matches the year of the actual debt service. The downside is, as you can see in the graph below, the total tax impact over time is higher if you do it that way than it is with an upfront tax impact. So what you see down there in the bottom is the two options that you have side by side. Natural tax increase in the left column, those are the years of the projects. Those are the years we would start needing money to be able to pay for debt for projects for ABSS and ACC. So the total is 10.5 cents, and you can see that we're projecting tax rates would need to be raised, not in 1920, the first tax rate increase would need to be raised in fiscal year 2021, and it would be 8.61 cents property tax rate that year. Then in 21-22, another 1.21 cents. No property tax rate increase needed in 22-23. And in 23-24, you would need a 0.23 cent property tax rate increase with a natural flow of the way the debt works. Total 10.05.
Brian, can you increase the size of that up there?
I don't know.
A little trouble
seeing
it.
It's a little blurry. Kind of before. I can't see it.
I'll tell you, I have a hard copy of it too. Let me give you a hard copy. Okay, that way, if you're having trouble seeing it for the lights, you can have a hard copy.
Dealing with senior
citizens.
I brought these
because
I'm afraid
technology.
All but
ain't. Right. Working. You don't need one.
That's
for your elders.
So we're on the page. It says timing of property tax increase.
Not much better.
We should have had this
in
the beginning.
Yeah.
Apologize. Yes, indeed. Okay. So your two options are a natural tax impact. As I was saying, it goes every year that the projects are occurring, they're actually hitting the ground, we're needing funding to make payments, they're occurring those years. The total, if we do it that way, we're estimating that's where we get our 10.05 cents. Or the board would have the option of doing a one-time property tax increase in fiscal year 1920, and it would be estimated to cover the entire cost of all the projects in the capital finance plan. That's all the bond debt. Yes, sir.
So how long would we expect those increases to occur? So through the retirement of the debt?
Yes.
20 years?
Yes. Indeed. So once you, if you raise it at 8.61, we're using that to pay off 20 years worth of that debt. So it's going up, and it needs to stay in place because it's paying off the debt. Or the board would have the option of doing a one-time 7.88-cent property tax increase in the first year. This would be, bonds would be voted for in November of 2018, and in fiscal year 18-19, that would be the following July, the board could consider raising the property tax one time, 7.88 cents, and that dollar amount would, there would be no more need for property tax increase throughout the life of the capital plan with the projects that are included in it today. You know, obviously there's a upside to this. This one-time increase would be coming immediately after the vote. So if the voters of Alamance County approve the bonds, you could communicate to them, bonds we estimate will cost 7.88 cent property tax increase. If you vote for these bonds, we would plan to raise the property tax immediately and start funding the entire plan that way. The downside is you really don't need those. That initial year, you're not having anything to pay out. You're holding it in a capital reserve in the debt model, in the capital model. So any proceeds from 7.88 cent property tax revenue that came in would go into the capital model and be there ready to start making debt payments, pay-go payments, whatever's needed the following year.
And we couldn't get any interest on that money were it put into that capital fund. Or is there any interest? I mean, what Bill's saying is probably very true, that interest will go up.
Right. Yeah, I think it's already up to 1.5. So you could probably, by then, you could make more money.
Yeah, you would invest those monies just like any other county funds and earn interest on them.
Even though it's a designated fund.
That's right.
That's right.
Is that figured into your?
We have not calculated what kind of interest earnings those might earn. That would be, you know, possible upside to this whole plan. And a couple of clarifications. There does come a time in these models where you can reduce the tax rate out in the future. As this debt is paying down, there is a point where the 10 pennies or the equivalent number of pennies could be reduced. But we're talking about a period of time out around 2024 or later. And presumably, that's the time where you all will be dealing with your next phase of projects.
That's when we start building some reserves in the plan. So that would be a choice the board would be looking at in those years is, do you want to cut taxes or do you want to leave things as they are and continue to put money into the capital plan reserve to handle whatever projects ACC or ABSS or county government may bring forward. So that would be something we would be bringing to you and reporting. There's this much money in capital reserve. We're projecting this much money in capital reserve. Do you want to go forward with that? I could imagine that would be helpful as, again, one thing we've tried to keep in mind as we've made this plan is this is not the total everything everybody needs. It's really, there are going to be other needs from the school system, from the community college, and frankly from county government that we can't foresee today. We think that having a reserve in one way is a good idea. It's there, it's ready to pay for projects as they come up, but it could also be some mix. You may want to reduce the tax rate somewhere.
Yeah, I do have an answer for you, and if you all have the book that we circulated, if you go to page 64, just so you know, you'll be able to see it. Page numbers are in the lower right corner. And if you look at column C, that is the new debt service associated with this plan, and you'll see that it hits its peak in 2023 at $18.2 million, which is about 13.5 pennies worth of revenue. That's just the new debt in this plan. $18.2 million is where it hits its peak. You'll see it steps up to that level, and then it begins to step back down. To the left of that, in column B, is the debt you have on the books today. And in that year, your existing debt is $7 million. So you've got $7 million in that year to pay for in your existing debt obligations. If this plan unfolds the way we've shown, In that year, there'll be another $18.2 million associated with this plan, and that, all of those together, plus the PAYGO there underlying column D, is what is needed, is the 10 pennies is needed to help supplement what you're currently paying into debt to afford all of that.
I hear you, but it appears that we're losing the 6 cents of current debt service. Is that right?
Current debt service is 9.8, so six to seven cents.
Okay. It just appears to me that we're almost acting like that savings doesn't exist or won't exist, or if it exists, it will only exist in partiality.
Well, the reality of how you budget for debt service today is, if you look at this page 64, it's the revenues that you're using are columns G through M. There are multiple sources of revenue that go into your debt budget today. It's not just 6 pennies. It's 6 different sources of funding that come in. And we are assuming that all of those sources of funding continue in the future.
Sure.
That you don't lose them, that you maintain them, and you keep them in your debt budget. And if you were to do that, what we're saying is you need the equivalent of another 10 pennies worth of revenue to supplement those current revenues to make this work. So we're not losing any funding that you're currently putting towards debt. We're maintaining it. But because this new debt plus the PAYGO steps up to almost another $20 million, that's where we have solved for we need the equivalent of about another 10 pennies worth of revenue to accommodate that.
Well, I would just say that my concern is to not have a lot of padding in there to where we really take more than we need.
Understood.
And before we do. Well, I'll just leave it at that for now. Mm-hmm. Now, there is a question between, let's say, the one on the left's A and the one on the right's B. Where did we say somewhere along the lines that there would be a $13 million more cost if we went with one versus the other? I heard that figure from somebody.
That's the structure of the principle, and we'll talk about that. That's one of the last things that we'll talk about today.
Okay.
We're almost there. We're getting there pretty quickly. But this is something that the board could consider today when we do our max estimated property tax rate for the resolution. Does this board believe that it would be in the best interest to do a upfront tax increase if bonds pass? And again, we're assuming the highest we can possibly assume, both bonds pass. And that would mean a 7.88-cent property tax increase the fiscal year directly after the vote, if they pass. Or does the board believe it's better to spread the tax rate increases out over the life of the projects as they start coming online? I don't know if anybody wants to speak about that before I move off or not. We can come back to it. I'll just keep going.
Well, let me ask you one more and tie it to Jeremy. Property reevaluation. Now, at what point can we talk about what we think is going to be the platform there in relation to all of this?
So with the reevaluation, you know, the conversation on the table is, when will the next one be? You know, are we going to go for an 8-year cycle? Are we going to go for a 6-year into a 4-year cycle? And right now, I don't have direction on that. That's something that in the budgetary process, I've laid out both versions and what that would look like. And that's a decision that would need to be made in the course of budgeting. Which one are we planning for?
I'm talking about the cycle we're in now.
Well, and that's the question, is what cycle are we in?
Well, I mean, when do we have property?
Maybe 8 years.
Well, I know that, but when did we find out the last time? I don't remember.
We're doing an 8-year cycle now, but Jeremy and I have talked about the possibility of going to a 6-year and what that cost would be. I think the state is really interested in counties trying to make that move.
When was the last time we had property reevaluation?
2017.
Yes.
We did?
Yeah.
Okay.
They did a good job. We didn't recognize it. Yes. We didn't recognize it. He did such a good job.
So, can I ask if Davenport had projected.
No, that's when it went into effect.
We didn't change anything with the reval cycle. It was just part of the budget.
It was just part of their.
I just don't remember the meeting. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
Yeah. That's okay. Yes, that yes.
It was part of last year's budget.
So did that, did you project any increase in tax base in these projections?
We did. We assumed a 1% per year growth in the county's tax base. I would call that, forget about rebound for a moment, I would just call that sort of natural growth, new construction type growth. And essentially what our model assumes is that in any given rebound year, you go revenue neutral with the rate, but for that 1% growth. Because at the end of the day, we're telling you we need, in this case, the equivalent of 10 pennies. What we really need is the dollars that 10 pennies will generate. So whether if tax base grows in the future, it might only be 9 pennies that we really need. But we have assumed only 1% growth.
I think that's very conservative.
I think that's a good rate.
Yeah.
At least 1% will grow that.
With our success of bringing in new employers, we could probably keep that.
Yeah. I think that's conservative.
Don't remember the
meeting. Yeah,
well, we have the chairman of our Board of Equalization and Review is here. Yeah. He can tell us about that we did a reval. We did a reval last year, right?
Yeah, and saved $900,000 to do it in-house purchase.
Right, I mean, now, yeah, I just don't remember the actual meeting. I apologize.
Well, so this will be,
at least I'm honest about it.
This will be a decision I think the board will need to debate a little today when we set the rate for the resolution is, how does this board feel about upfront versus separate? I won't belabor the point, we can come back to it.
You're gonna ask what if I had any opinions.
Well, yes, if someone.
Well, I have an opinion, I would just as soon do the upfront, get it out there, and then it's set, and it's a lower rate, I think it would serve the taxpayers overall better. Then to wait a couple of years and then go up a higher rate, which stays with us for a long period of time.
Yes. Very well. The next factor that we need to talk about, everything we've talked about so far, the 10.05 cents that occurs just from the difference in the timing of the projects for ABSS, ACC, as well as the idea of the possibility of an upfront tax rate increase as opposed to one that goes over a multi-year period, have all been assuming that we would be using what we've come to call a separate model. So in your plan has a separate model numbers and it also has combined model numbers. But I wanted to describe what the separate model is. So in a separate model in this capital plan, the county and the school system and the community college, all our plans would be separate. They would happen in silos, separate from each other. Revenues would be and reserves would be dedicated just for specific projects for each entity, right? So current county reserves that we have about $3.4 million in reserve right now from the sale of Peak property. That would remain in the county silo only to be applied toward county projects. County debt capacity, we're paying down our debt quicker than we are paying down ABSS or ACCs. In a separate model, it stays in the county. It only benefits county government. ABSS and ACC would see benefit from their debt being paid down. It's just not as quick, but it would be their capacity, strictly theirs. We would track it that way. There's some pros to this model, separate. It's very easy to identify available revenues for future projects. That particularly is true with county. It's always going to be we're tracking school system revenues. We're always tracking those. But with county revenues in the separate model, it's a little easier because we're county government, if you'll recall, pays all of ACC's capital needs, both PAYGO and debt, as well as our own. And it's very easy also in this model, separate, to communicate the impact of the tax rate for each bond, right? So it's easy to say out of that out of that 7.88 cent tax rate increase that would be needed, how much of that is due to the school system need, how much of that is due to the community college's need. The downside is the separate model takes a higher property tax rate impact than a combined model would. The reason is, again, the county is really bringing a lot to the table because we have debt paying down very quickly and we have a large amount of reserves we can throw into the mix. Separate model, we don't do that. We keep that in our projects. So when we look at what does that mean for a combined model? Combined model is where in the plan, all available revenues and capital reserves are appropriated as needed within the capital finance plan. This means that we're taking early on, we're not separating out county projects or just county money. We're saying county reserve dollars can go to help offset costs of ACC debt or ABSS debt or their PAYGO up front. It would all be working together, particularly our money. Again, I want to stress, if we went combined, we would want to be sure that we entered into some kind of agreement with the school system where we're very clear with ABSS, we're using your revenues properly, that we're on the same page, how we use lottery funds and restricted sales tax. We're required to do that by law anyway, but we want to make sure the school system understood that. But we believe we could foresee, based on our plan, another reduction in property tax impact to 7.12 cents if the commissioners were interested in going into a combined model. So this would be a combined upfront. So right now, about the lowest tax rate we could be talking about is 7.12 cents. That would be if the board, based on the timing of the projects, you can see in the graph, right? We went from 12 to 13 cents. That was our original estimate, everything right up front. Timing of the projects alone has brought us down to 10.05. If the commissioners were interested in doing a upfront tax impact, that would get it down to 7.88 in our best estimate. And if we use the combined model instead of separate, we believe we would be looking at a 7.12 cent property tax impact. That would be in the first year, 1920, but that is using all of the county's supporting revenues to make it keep the property tax impact low.
Mr. Haygood, for purposes of our resolution that we're considering today, will we be voting to send to the LGC a 10.05 cent rate, or can we combine the capital and do the other things that we were talking about? Can we send the 7.12 cent rate to the LGC as being what we expect the highest tax impact to be?
The board could put any of these numbers in the resolution that it feels comfortable with. I think what we need to be sure we understand is that we would be allowed to deviate from what we put in the resolution if the at bond sale time interest rates are higher, as Mr. Lashley says. That may be the only way we're able to deviate. So if we say
to go
above 7.12, if you choose 7.12,
that's the minimum.
Yes,
really, it's what we're saying with that. Now, lottery funds, aren't they? I mean, aren't they designated? How do we combine in this?
If we're looking at a combined model, there would always be a reconciliation done during budget time as well as the end of the year to make sure that. For the school system, lottery funds are only being applied to their debt and not to be applied to ACC nor to the county's
right.
debt.
When you say combined, that gets a little
so
muddy.
So even though we would look at having a combined model and utilizing the county's capacity to help cover more of the ACC bonds as well as the Alamance Burlington school system bonds, we would still have to account for them separately.
Okay, so we're just trying to put it together for the looks part.
Yes.
So would it be accurate to say in the combined model, the reason why we can do it with a lower interest rate or lower tax rate is because we're using some cash flow from the county's fund balance to meet the cash needs during any given year, but in the end, over a period of time, it evens out, it reconciles. Is that what's
where that's really coming into, Commissioner Byrd, is as the county is paying down our debt, then by leaving the tax rate where it is, it creates that capacity that those funds, instead of being moved into operational needs, would stay within this debt model, so that those funds are there to help offset that tax, is so that it's not a higher tax rate that we're needing to cover the debt service for those years. We're able to use those funds in a subsequent year to keep that property tax at the recommended level.
Okay, so let me ask a follow-up.
Well, I will say, too, that your question about the fund balance, we do have approximately $3.4 million of funds designated right now for county facility needs that came from the sale of Peak property. Those are in designated fund balance. In the combined model, yes, those would be put into play wherever needed. But as you say, the county's needs are also going to be met in the plan without affecting the property tax rate. So it would be a mix of county reserves. It would also be county debt capacity in a combined model go in to help offset ACC and ABSS costs. And that's why you start getting the lower property tax rate increase needed.
So, Susan, you said something about funds that are currently used for operational. currently.
So what the county has had to do in the past, because what this model will do is it will put us into a debt service model where we are locking in the level of funding for 18-19. That would be the max. And everything else is, for when, and I'm saying the max is what the county is currently contributing. We would always commit to contribute those funds to the debt service model. Where we're coming in for this part would be as we're paying that down, then that capacity gets to help the offset. So what we've been in the past is when we've had some debt capacity come down, we've had operational needs that we've had to use those monies to help in the operational side, and what we would do is no longer do that moving forward.
Well, that's what I was concerned about, because I know we fund lots of operational things for ABSS, and so are we going to be hamstring a little bit to continue?
It will make it more difficult.
Operational needs.
Yes.
It will make it more difficult to fund operational needs doing it this way, and I think the only reason we've really looked at this model is because of the scope of the debt, the $189.6 million. It's such a large amount that beyond more than we've ever borrowed before, it seemed to push us to a point to say we need to make sure we set ourselves up to where we can pay for that and all our other debt needs too. But it will put pressure on operations.
Well, I'm not sure if I'm all that comfortable with that, because you know these operations and the capital all have to work together.
Yeah. Yes. Now you do have some other options that we can continue looking at. Though, so
yes.
So for the difference between 7.88 and 7.12.
Yes. So that would, I will say too, we have another slide on the combined model. Pros of going combined, it does take it down to 7.12 cents. That is because the county's debt capacity and the county's reserves are coming into play, right? We're putting them in play for the whole plan, not just county government. And the downside is the flow of our funds is not as transparent in the separate model. So now our funding, our county debt capacity starts being applied to ABSS needs, ACC needs. Our reserves start filling in gaps for ACC, ABSS needs. I would suggest to the board, this is just my own thoughts, that we would only use a combined model if we did the upfront tax increase. And the suggestion being we're putting our reserves in play. If we do the separate and a board decides not to raise taxes, we could wind up maybe losing our $3.4 million. We've already spent it. And a subsequent board says we're not going to hold to the plan, then our money is gone. So really, to me, if we're trying to make sure we protect county reserves, then we would want to only use the combined model if we're doing the upfront property tax increase. Also, the other downside to the combined model, it does make it a little more difficult to communicate what the impact of the tax rate is by ABSS and ACC's bonds, because all of a sudden now our capacity is at play with them. So if you look in the separate model, we can tell you how many pennies it's taken to do ABSS bond, how many pennies it takes to do ACC bond, how many pennies it takes to do county needs, none. So when you combine, it muddies that up a little bit. So what we've decided is probably the most fair way to explain to the public, 7.12 cents, how much of that is for ABSS's needs, how much of that is for ACC's needs. We've taken the total amount of the bond, $189.6 million. $150 million of that, about 79%, is for ABSS. $39.6 million, about 21% of that amount, is for ACC. So we've broken it up that way where you could say approximately 5.62 cents of the 7.12 is for ABSS. 1.5 of the 7.12 is for ACC. It's just a way to try to explain to the public what's driving the need for the property tax increase. So the last point we need to speak about a little bit is the structuring debt. So generally when bond debt is issued, it's issued on a level principal methodology. You pay in the same amount every year. Your interest payments decrease over time. This is all 20-year. All this debt we're talking about today, the bond debt, is all 20-year debt. Debt service payments are higher in the first years because you're paying it as you pay it down. The amount gets lower as you go.
So for the general public, this is what I learned a month or two ago. This is not like mortgaging your house where your debt service remains equal.
Yes.
in this case, in government debt, typically you have the principal payments are equal.
That's right.
Not the entire debt service payments.
That's correct. And in that model, your early payments are higher. They're more, right? It gets less as you go throughout the life of the debt, the 20 years. We've looked at the possibility of using a structured principal option. Why would we look at that? We would look at that because it makes the upfront early year payments less. So it reduces the amount of property tax impact that's needed up front. And what you're doing is you're pushing your principal out, your higher payments are going to be at the end, but that's also when you have more debt capacity from paying off other debt, right? So that's coming in the mix to help make payments then. Downside to structured principal, it does increase interest costs. This, Mr. Sutton, is where I believe we talked about the need for on the bond debt, it was going to add, I think, $13 million in interest if we use structured principal. But you can see in red there on your sheets the possible property tax impact. So we've talked about options that have gone from 10.05, 7.88, 7.12, that is upfront tax raise and a combined model. Well, if we use structured debt, we think that it could possibly go as low as 5.40 cents. That is a little bit of an aggressive look at how we could possibly structure. I want to take this opportunity, too, if I can find my... Yes, sir. No, please go ahead.
So you said doing the 5.4 cents because of the way the principal is retired, it retires more slowly, therefore we're going to pay more interest. That would add about $13 million worth of debt service over a period of 20 years?
Yes, it adds interest that we would be paying.
Interest, so it's some...
And just added interest.
Yes.
So I would just point out that in my finance training, when you look at either costs or savings over a long period of time and it adds up to a big number, it really doesn't, it's not a good measure unless you discount those payments according to time, because a dollar is worth less 20 years from now than it is today.
Certainly.
And absolutely. So there's a methodology of discounting those extra interest payments back and putting it in a present value term of what that cost really is, and it'd probably be a whole lot less.
Yes. And I need to...
Maybe our Davenport consultants can figure that out real quick.
Well, I will say, before we go any further, Susan and Andrea and Ted and I went down the other week and visited with the folks at the Local Government Commission, because this is... the Local Government Commission is the agency under the state treasurer that we work with to take on this debt. And, they're who we're going to apply for to be able to issue these bonds. So we felt like it was probably wise to go meet with those folks, because they generally don't like this model of structure. They don't look on it as kindly as they do the level principal model. So we went down and met with them, and I brought back a couple of things I want to relay to you that I assured the folks at the LGC that I would relay. Their comments about the possibility of the county, Alamance County, using structured debt. They were concerned that if we structured debt now, we might not be able to do it again when we really need financial help for borrowing. Their one comment was that structured debt is not a good idea for tax management. So, and that's kind of what we would be doing here, is we want to keep the property tax impact low. In the LGC's opinion, that's not always a wise practice. The LGC indicated that we're in a rapid growth area, and we might see new school needs come very quickly and unexpectedly. And if we have a structured debt on the books, it could make it more difficult to get new debt easily. They also commented that structured debt puts greater payments out when the paid-for infrastructure is more worn. So you're paying more at the end of the life of the thing that you're financing. And they were concerned about the fact that we would be paying more interest than we would in level principal. I say all these things because it is an option that is available to us to pursue. I think based on the reaction from the LGC and from the staff there, I think if we were going to pursue it, we would need a consensus from this board and then members of this board to come with staff and folks from Davenport to have that discussion with the folks at the LGC to make sure they understand that the board is serious about this and really wants to do it. I would not feel comfortable recommending to you to use 5.40 in this resolution today. I think it's just important that you see it, you know that it exists, and we get some feedback from you about, do you want to pursue this any further or not? If so, we need to start making those motions to the LGC. But it is an option for us. And
I've got something to say about that.
Sir?
if it were the pleasure of the board to say that this board considered the structured principal method to be in the best interest of Alamance County and the best interest of our taxpayer, I would be more than happy to go to the LTC and explain to them why we set the tax policy and we set we have the fiscal responsibility to the taxpayers of Alamance County. And in my opinion, you know, I'm not saying whether or not I think the structure principle is the right thing to do or not. Completely aside from that, in my opinion, we represent Alamance County. And if it is legal, then the LGC should allow it. If it's illegal, then obviously they wouldn't. I think that should be up to this board.
To the best interest of the county.
So there's clearly a separation of priorities here. You know, one is the appropriators, government.
True.
And the other one is, as Amy is saying, which I totally agree with, who's paying it?
Right.
Sir.
Now, who do you think the taxpayers would rather, what do you think they'd rather see on their bill every year on their property?
That's right.
One versus the other.
And we answer to the taxpayer.
You get the same bill done.
Yeah.
We answer to the taxpayer.
I understand that point. There's something to be said that it kind of comes down to a matter of short-term versus long-term. Because, I mean, I could go either way. I like the idea of having, it'll sell better.
Option of structure.
It might have a higher chance of passing these bonds if the rate is as low as we can get it.
It's key.
But there is that, long-term cost that we're going to be kicking the can down the road to a future board of commissioners by doing that.
Well, my point is that whether or not we choose the structure principle, that should be a decision that we make, not that Raleigh makes.
Well, and I would comment on that is that the reason why North Carolina has such financial strength when it comes to issuing debt is because of the local government commission and their policies.
Well, that would be something we would consider in making the decision about which structure we decide to go with.
Yeah.
Is what do we think is the right thing? But I would be happy to go with the county staff to the LGC and would ask one of the other commissioners to go with me and make our case.
Right.
And I don't know, Ted or Mitch, if you have anything you'd like to add about structured principle. I think I've assured the folks at LGC that I would communicate their concerns to the board, and they understand that exactly what you're saying, Madam Chair, that the commissioners make those decisions. They wanted to ensure that I communicate that. And I don't know, Ted, if you have anything
else to add. No, I think it's been a good conversation. I can assure you that the structuring that we've done is absolutely legal within North Carolina state statutes, and there are some very specific statutes about general obligation bonds, how much structuring you can do, and where the limit is, and we've stayed within those, and we know of a number of local government issuers over the years that have taken advantage of that for one reason or another. And so without question, the LGC staff, and it may rise up to the commission itself, have a preference for level principal, but in our minds, if it's something that is of interest to you all, I think every situation is a little bit different, and I think as long as people go into it knowing the cost benefit, because I don't think one is right and one is wrong, they're just different. And yes, there is additional interest expense,
but the value of dollars is different.
I mean, they're both paid off in 20 years, but one pays off more quickly than the other, therefore it has less interest. But there's a trade-off in this case of the tax rate. So I think that is a very productive conversation to have. And while the staff's initial reaction was, we're not in favor of that, and you should pass that along. I don't think that means the conversation is over, if you all would
now,
like to pursue.
Now, you represent other counties in doing the same issue, right?
Correct.
How many other counties in North Carolina have gone on their bonds to structure debt?
I don't know the exact number, but I would say that the majority of the bond issues that do get done in North Carolina are probably level principal, tax-supported projects. But I know of a number of places that have chosen to do one level of structuring or another. And it's not an all or nothing.
Right.
It's not an all or nothing proposition. There is multiple ways that you can structure debt within the two bookends that we've created. And so it happens with some regularity, and again, it's something that from my more recent conversations with LGC staff, probably would rise to the level of the actual commission itself, you know, being made aware of the county's desires, if that is what you all want to do, and getting perspective.
So it's not impossible.
I don't believe
that's
so.
What I'm hearing.
Where along the continuum is your 5.4 cent? Is it kind of towards the limit of what how we can structure?
Yes, it's towards the limit of what we would say would be a reasonable structuring case. We have held ourselves from the statutes do allow for some very specific math about how much structuring you can do. We have not necessarily taken advantage of all of that. We have held ourselves to a few other parameters that we believe are important for the purposes of the rating agencies and your bond rating. So we haven't necessarily taken full advantage of the structuring flexibility that is out there, but we have taken advantage of some, and the limitations we've imposed in this model are to try to present this in a manner that is more reasonable from a rating agency perspective.
So you could back it off if you chose to get that 5.4 cent to 6 cents.
Correct. There is a number of, I don't want to say infinite, but many, many, many cases we could run between those two.
Which may appeal a little bit more.
There may be a more appealing structure than the one we've shown, so I think that would be part of the conversation if we wanted it to continue.
And we included several slides about how it could work, and I'm not going to go through them because it sounds like there is some interest. It sounds like the court also understands that there are various levels of structuring that we could do. And I do want to communicate to you that I don't believe it would be wise to use that figure in this resolution. I don't think that would be a good idea, but you need to know it's there, and we needed to hear, is this something that you may be interested in? And I understand your point about the taxpayers would be interested in seeing. And again, this is why we had this discussion. Going back to the original point of the plan, if these bonds pass, what can we do to make it as affordable as possible? This is a tool in the toolbox. So, final point to talk about a little bit is a quarter cent sales tax. The board knows that we have Article 46 available to Alamance County, a sales tax referendum. We could put a sales tax referendum before the public in November. And that would take a resolution from this board to go to the Board of Elections before mid-May of this year, if the board wanted to do that, because about at that time of year, Kathy's folks are working on getting early ballots ready, and absentee ballots and all those things are getting prepared. So if the commissioners were interested in Article 46 sales tax referendum before the public in November, mid-May would be the target. We need to have a resolution approved by the board before mid-May. We've talked about in other meetings, and it's in your book, information about we estimate using a model Davenport helped us create that Article 46 sales tax for Alamance County would generate about $4.8 million. That is based on looking at counties in the Piedmont that have Article 46, how their collections are going, how they collect the other sales tax items that we do have, and then an average of those. So that equals out about 3.62 cents. So when you look at your graph now on the page before you, you can see all the numbers that we've talked about today. 12.19, that was the original, back to old times, back to what we know now is not going to happen. 10.05 cents, that's if the commissioners take no other action today. That's what we believe would need to go on our resolution and what we would put out to the public. But with a sales tax item that was successful, I believe it goes down to 9.4 perhaps. Then we've also talked about if the commissioners put in a resolution today that 7.88 cents, that means that the board would do an upfront property tax impact increase if the bonds were voted in successfully. A successful quarter cent Article 46 sales tax vote would take the needed rate increase down to 4.23 cents. And then if we use the combined model, that's the lowest that we've talked about so far, 7.12 cents. That's upfront, that's timing of the projects, That's an upfront property tax increase in fiscal year 1920. That is, that's it. That's combined model. Then if the sales tax were successful, the rate would be the property tax rate increase would only need to be 3.52 cents. And then, of course, you could see, you get all the way down to the maximum amount of structuring we could do, you could possibly be looking at 1.9 cents. Those are a little speculative. That's the speculative end of the spectrum. But the bottom line, you can see that a quarter cent sales tax that was dedicated toward the capital plan, the proceeds dedicated toward the capital plan, has a significant impact in how much the property tax would need to be raised. What we would suggest you think about is, if the board is interested in this, and we'll certainly be able to hear feedback today, is the consideration of a resolution that would put this Article 46 on the ballot in November of 2018, and also a consideration of a resolution by the board that would indicate what you would want to do with the proceeds if it were successful, so the public knows what happens if they voted in. So I don't know if there was any discussion about Article 46 or any questions.
Go back to the lowest we can do the property tax, whether we, the 13, and it's going to cost more, obviously, but, you know, the lowest that, you know, Amy and I were saying we possibly would like. 5.4. And if you did the sales tax and the sales tax was approved, mm-hmm. How much property tax? You may have answered it. I'm sure you did. I just didn't hear it. What would the property tax rate be if the sales tax passed and we were targeting, looking at the lowest level?
The maximum amount of structure.
Yeah.
1.9.
So you did answer that. Two cents.
Two cents. Right there on, okay. Yeah, kind of in the bottom.
Again, that
I
is.
I want to make sure I walk out here knowing.
That is a speculative number, but we wanted to include it. It is the maximum amount of structuring, and it would hinge on the voters passing Article 46.
Best case scenario.
Now, one more question on the sales tax. What percentage of that sales tax would we assume would be paid by people who don't even live in the county?
I don't know that I could answer that question. I'm not sure if there's a good metric that we could even pull out to answer that.
I think the chamber has done some research on that.
It's a high percentage.
It's like 60% or so.
Wow.
From out of the county?
Is it proper to make a motion that we support the sales tax, a quarter percent sales tax increase?
Well, I think if I hear that there's a consensus, then we've already worked with the county attorney to look at models of ones. Then if that's something the board is interested in, you don't need to vote on that today. Just tell me, and we will bring at a subsequent meeting, either before mid-May, we will bring you a resolution to consider that says the commissioners would allow the Article 46 to be put on the ballot.
I think we definitely need to do that.
I'm in favor of it.
Yeah.
I think we need to put it on the agenda so that the public has notice.
Absolutely.
That they're thinking about it. Because this is kind of spraying it on them.
The deadline to get it on the ballot is what, Clyde?
Well, I think it'll save the property taxpayers some money.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Well, as long as before mid-May, we get the resolution that the board approves over to the Board of Elections, there's time for it to be on the November ballot. The other thing I would suggest, and I'd be interested to hear your feedback on this too, is would the board consider some type of resolution that would give the public the idea of what you would do with the proceeds? Because these funds are able to be used by the county for any purpose at all. So, you know, if you're going to put it before the public, they would probably want to know, what's the plan? What would you want to do with it? We can draft a resolution that says the proceeds would be used for this capital plan purpose, including these bonds for ACC and ADSS.
We did that in 2012.
Yes.
With a $15 million bond issue for ACC, specifically letting the public know that that's what the proceeds would be used for. But in that case, it didn't pass.
That's right.
Well, but you weren't talking about a property tax increase with those bonds either.
No, not the extent of this, right.
This is a little bit different sale here, I think.
So bottom line is 3.62 cent lower property tax by doing the sales tax.
If you committed all of the revenue that we would estimate to receive from Article 46 to this capital plan.
So I have a question. So today, we need to pass a resolution to establish a maximum property tax rate, right?
Yes.
And so I'm thinking there's an advantage of having a higher tax, maximum tax rate. Just it gives us more flexibility, but it may send the wrong message if we say, well, we're going to go with a 10-cent property tax increase as a maximum, then everybody might think that that's what it's going to be, when in fact it probably wouldn't be.
I think what we're trying to do is give them the options we have as a board to set a final outcome to the citizen that pays property tax.
Well, today we have to pass a maximum.
And that is the balance. The balance is telling the public what the cost is and giving yourself enough flexibility in the event, our understanding right now is once you set this rate, you could only go up if interest rates increased and things like that happen.
Right.
So we desire to communicate to the public the cost. That's staff's desire to communicate to you, the board, and to the public. If both bonds pass, the cost would be this. So this is the opportunity to do that through this resolution. And you've heard different things that you might could do. Really, the main point to consider that makes the most difference is, would the board be willing to raise the property tax immediately instead of natural?
Natural.
Yes, where it rolls every year. That's the main point to deliberate, I think, because you go from 10 cents to 7.8 if the board says that's what we would do. And you put in the resolution. You can take it further if you say, we would do the upfront tax, and we would also want staff to manage this through a combined model. And you can take it down to estimated 7.1.
Well, I'm in favor of
7.8.
Doing the upfront tax. I've got reservations right this second about doing the combined model, and then I'm pretty much in favor of the pursuing the structure. So that gets it down. So I have to switch the order here of these. Of this.
I think that would take you to 7.88 only because I would.
Would take us below that because it would include the upfront
structure.
Tax structure.
Right.
So that knocks another cent and a half.
I would just be cautious about using the structured rate in the resolution, because again, that is going to take going down to the LGC.
Oh, okay.
I believe we've heard today that the board will do that and wants to pursue that. For the resolution purpose, and I don't know if Ted or Susan, you have any commentary on this, for the resolution's purpose, I would almost caution the board not to include it in the resolution, just because we still would have to go through the local government commission. And I believe it is legal. I believe we can do it, but there's also varying degrees of structuring we might do. It may not go all the way down to 5.4. It might be, as you mentioned, I think, Mr. Byrd, 6 or something. We know 7.88. We feel pretty confident about that, putting it before you.
That's the number you're comfortable with.
Either that or 7.12, but the 7.12 is using combined, and that's a little more.
I don't like combined.
Well, 7.88 is good. I would be in favor of that, but we really need to communicate that. Even though that would be the maximum, there are options for us to get it much lower than that,
yes,
and that people know that.
Well, and that's what this is for, so the public can know what their vote's going to cost them.
So at this point, I think further discussion, obviously, I've completed everything that I have to present to you. Our next step is today to approve the resolution that's in your packet with a maximum estimated property tax rate impact. I've also heard that there's a consensus for us to start working on sales tax resolution and a resolution for purpose of those proceeds.
About the resolution for purpose of proceeds, I would like to know if the board consider, instead of saying if we get a quarter cent sales tax passed, we promise we will use it for this capital plan, what if the bonds don't pass but the sales tax does? And so I was wondering if the board would consider a resolution to just promise or dedicate the sales tax funds to education, whether it is the community college or the public school system.
I'm okay with that.
Well, I think that's where we would rely on Mr. Albright to help us draft a resolution that would be appropriate if the bonds pass or they do not.
Right.
I think
come up when we vote to put it on the ballot.
And we would give you the opportunity to review that resolution before it came before you. So.
I can give you a copy of the one we did in 2012. Like, I can email it.
I'm not totally in favor of the combined, I think. I'm a little leery of that.
Yeah, I'm a little leery.
Very well. Well, it doesn't mean it's completely off the table, but
right.
it would that would mean for this resolution's purposes, you'd be looking at 7.88 cents as the figure you put in the, and I would be, it would be unfair of me to go any further without asking Susan. Susan, finance officer, do you have any other thoughts on what we're talking about?
No, I would be comfortable with the 7.88 in the resolution as well. It's setting the parameter that the board is looking for, and it meets the LGC requirement.
And we'll work to work that down.
You need a motion for that?
Well, there's a resolution that will need to be read, and then we can entertain it.
We're not to that point yet.
Yeah, we've got it. It's in our, in our packet. Amy's got it. Want me to read it, ma'am?
Want me to read it?
Yes.
Or you want me to start? A special meeting of the Board of Commissioners? Is that where I need to start reading?
I think you can start after the commissioner.
Madam Chair, before you start, I just do want to make sure everybody's on the same page, that this would mean the property tax rate would be increased after the vote. If both bonds were successful, the very next fiscal year, we would be doing the entire increase of that at that time. Okay.
That's if the bonds pass.
Yes.
Yes.
All right. And so you want me to start with Commissioner Blank?
Start right below there.
Yes, Commissioner Blank.
All right. Whereas?
Supplemental resolution.
Okay. Supplemental resolution relating to the authorization of general obligation bonds of the County of Alamance, North Carolina. Whereas the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, North Carolina, parentheses, the quote county quote, close parentheses, is considering authorizing the issuance of not exceeding 150 million school bonds of the county, parentheses, quote, school bonds, close quote, close parentheses, with voter approval pursuant to Article 4 of Chapter 159 of the North Carolina General Statutes as amended, for the purpose of providing funds with any other available funds for erecting additional school buildings and other school plant facilities, enlarging, reconstructing, renovating, and replacing existing school buildings and other school plant facilities, and acquiring any necessary land, furnishings, equipment, and appurtenant facilities, therefore, in order to provide additional school facilities in the county. And whereas the Board of Commissioners for the county is considering authorizing the issuance of not exceeding 39,600,000 community college bonds of the county, parentheses, the quote community college bonds, close quote, close parentheses, with voter approval pursuant to Article 4 of Chapter 159 of the North Carolina General Statutes as amended, for the purpose of providing funds with any other available funds for expanding and improving the facilities for Alamance Community College, including the construction of additional buildings and other facilities, the enlargement, reconstruction, renovation, and repair of existing buildings and other facilities, and the acquisition of any necessary land, furnishings, equipment, and appurtenant facilities, therefore, and whereas it is necessary to take certain related action at this time, now, therefore, be it determined and resolved by the Board of Commissioners for the county as follows. Section 1. Said board hereby finds and determines that in connection with authorizing the issuance of such bonds that, little I, the proceeds of the school bonds will be used to finance a portion of the cost of the projects determined to be needed by the Alamance-Burlington Board of Education, parentheses, quote, Board of Education, close quote, close parentheses, to meet urgent needs for additional improved school facilities, to serve the residents of the county, and the proceeds of community college bonds will be used to finance a portion of the cost of the projects determined to be needed by the trustees of Alamance Community College, parentheses, quote, the quote, trustees, close quote, close parentheses, to meet urgent needs for additional improved community college facilities to serve the residents of the county, and accordingly, the issuance of such bonds, parentheses, collectively, the quote bonds, close quote, close parentheses, is necessary or expedient for the county. Small 2i, the principal amounts of the bonds are adequate and not excessive for the proposed and prospective purposes of the bonds, because they are based upon the best estimates of the Board of Education and the trustees of the cost of the respective projects, and take into account any other funds available for the respective purposes of the bonds. Small 3i, the county's debt management procedures and policies are good and will be managed in strict compliance with the law. Small ib, Roman numeral 4, the increase in taxes necessary to service the bonds will not be excessive, because it is expected that any increase in taxes will not exceed 7.88 cents per $100 of the appraised value of property subject to taxation by the county. And small Roman numeral 5, the bonds can be marked at reasonable rates of interest. Section 2, this resolution supplements the resolution entitled Resolution Relating to the Authorization of General Obligation Bonds of the County of Alamance, North Carolina, that was passed by said board on March 16, 2018. Section 3, this resolution shall take effect immediately upon its passage.
And Mr. Lashley's made a motion, and I will second that.
Now, are we locked in on 189 point whatever?
No, you are not. You still have two opportunities to discuss the total dollar amount of the bonds. So on April 2nd, you'll call for the public hearing. As we have here on the board, your next steps are April 2nd, call for a public hearing. That's an opportunity where if the board wanted to stop this process or start making changes, that is possible. And then on April 16th, public hearing, folks will come and tell you what they think about the bonds, and that's where you make your final decision about bond amounts and putting it to the ballot and proceeding.
We're locked in on this quote.
Yes, okay. Subject to situations when bonds are issued that require that we have to do more property tax, like interest rates are through the roof or something like that.
All right, so we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed, say no. And so that passes by a 5-0 vote.
Thank you, Commissioners. I believe that concludes all the information that I had today.
So. Okay, one thing that I wanted to add is that on March 1st, we did have a meeting. Mr. Lashley and I attended that. It was also attended by the chair of the Alamance Burlington Board of Education, and Mr. Gatewood was there with Cindy Colley, and the finance officer for ABSS was there, and county staff was there. And there were some questions about what was discussed at that meeting. Generally, it was a review of the same information that we've seen presented today, along with the information that we received about our bond rating at the last county commissioner meeting. The one thing that was different about it that I can recall is that I had questions about how the roofs were included in the facilities plan, that the $150 million includes renovating the roofs. And then we had a $4 million item in the plan for working with the roofs. And then the CIP plan provided by the school system that I think is in Appendix C included roof repair. And so my question at that time was whether or not that was triple dipping on the roofs, if we were paying for the same roofs three times. And the answer that the ABSS finance officer gave at that time was that no, that those were for different, they were all for roofs, but for different roof purposes. If anybody else on the board has questions about that, Mr. Lashley, you were there.
Yeah.
Was there anything else that we talked about?
That was pretty much it. That was pretty much the discussion.
So if you all would like to hear, the finance officer is here. She can address that at this time if you all want to hear from her.
We talked about this at our last meeting, because when the ABSS and Dr. Harrison presented the spending plan for the ABSS that added up to $150 million, there was an allowance for roofs in there, but the question was asked, I asked the question as to if you did everything on that list, it would add up to more than $150 million. And
right.
So as we implement, or the school systems implement the spending of these bond proceeds, they're going to have to prioritize some of the higher priority things are going to be done at the expense of what they deem are lower priorities, and I would think that roofs are going to be higher priorities. So is that right, Shannon?
Should be at the top of the list.
Okay, does anybody else have any questions or comments about that?
Oh, we got back quickly on roofs, but you know, you think schools are the only ones that have leaking roofs. I was over in Winston-Salem Saturday at
what was the name of that
hotel over Brown and something? What is it? For the refurbished the warehouse.
It's an old textile mill, and it's really nice. And I was down at the desk, and I heard the manager calling guests that were to come in, and they didn't have hardly any snow, just a little bit of rain. And he was saying, due to all the rain and all the snow, some of our roofs are leaking.
Uh-oh.
Some of our roofs have water in them. And I thought, you know,
build a flat roof, it's going to happen.
Well, it does change a person's perspective. I go over to UNC hospitals and look at their roofs, and I think, oh, Lord.
Flat roofs, that does it every time.
All right, if there's no other business before the board, then we'll be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.